Hi, I'm Sandy Rose, gospel music historian and host of The Sandy Rose Show on the Stellar nominated WVTC gospel radio station right here in Detroit. We're so glad that you could come for this special installment for Black Music Month of the Black Church in Detroit as we discuss the music of the Black Church in Detroit. The Black Church in Detroit is an award-winning television series airing monthly on American Black Journal. Additionally, the Black Church in Detroit Watch Parties won an award from the Society of Professional Journalists Detroit Chapter's Annual Excellence in Broadcasting Awards in the category of Social Media Strategy. This watch party will be our fifth in the ongoing series. Tonight's event is made possible through an ongoing initiative of Detroit Public Television called the Black Church in Detroit, which airs monthly on American Black Journal and is in partnership between the Detroit Public Television, the Ecumenical Theological Seminary, and the Charles H. Wright Museum of African American History. Now, let's go to Stephen Henderson, the host of America Black Journal, who will tell us more about this important initiative.
I'm Stephen Henderson, the host of American Black Journal. Throughout this year, Detroit Public Television is taking an in-depth look at the important role of the Black Church in Detroit, both past and present. Each month, we're going to dedicate an episode of American Black Journal to telling the story of the Black Church and its influence in the community. I'm really excited about this series, so make sure you join us on Sundays at 9:30 a.m. and Wednesdays at 7:30 p.m.
Although Chicago is known as the birthplace of gospel music, some of the best known gospel music of the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s was birthed right here in Detroit churches and community groups. Some of the gospel music pioneers, which we will touch on later, left their indelible mark on the fabric of gospel music in the Black churches around the country, and the fruit of their labor is still being recognized today. Detroit is also the birthplace of the Gospel Music Workshop of America, a music convention that was organized here in Detroit by the King of Gospel himself, Reverend James Cleveland, and at its height boasted of over 20,000 members worldwide. The Detroit sound, even today, is unique and admired throughout the world by gospel music performers, aficionados, and enthusiasts. Tonight, we will have what I want to call a super panel of Detroit personalities known for their exceptional gifts in gospel music. It's my pleasure to introduce them currently. Let's start with Dr. Deborah Smith Pollard. Dr. Deb is a professor of English literature and humanities at the University of Michigan Dearborn. She is the author of several books and articles, some of which stem from her research in praise and worship in the urban church and the changes in attire in gospel music. Deborah is a Stellar Award and Emmy Award winning gospel announcer who recently celebrated 40 years as an on-air gospel personality right here in Detroit. Between her weekly television shows like God Sounds and hosting the McDonald Gospel Fest and her radio broadcast, she has helped keep the community abreast of the happenings in Detroit gospel. Our next panelist is Alvin Waddles. Alvin is one of the most successful African-American musicians of the 20th century. Mr. Waddles has worked in the Detroit and Ann Arbor public schools and currently serves as musical consultant, musical director for the Mount Vernon Public Schools. His resume includes serving as musical director and or pianist for numerous theatrical productions, including The Wiz, The Color Purple, Dream Girls, Chorus Line, West Side Story, Sophisticated Ladies, and the Three Mo Tenors, and their touring productions and recordings. Alvin has served as minister of music of several churches, among them the historic New Bethel Baptist Church, Hartford Memorial Baptist Church, and Hope United Methodist in Southfield. Let's welcome Alvin to tonight's panel. Our next panelist is Lisa Whitmore Davis. Lisa is an innovator and sought-after thought leader on healthy aging issues and creator of innovative equity and inclusion solutions. Her professional career includes experiences in government, higher education, and nonprofits such as AARP, the County of Wayne, Wayne State University, Focus Hope, and the Michigan Senate. She is a sought-after soloist and faithful member of Greater Christ Baptist Church, where, after many years of singing, she recently joined a choir for the first time. She's also a member of AKA Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated and the Lynx Incorporated. And rounding out tonight's panel, we have none other than Bishop Andre Sonny Woods. Bishop Woods has studied and performed with some of the greatest gospel musicians, artists, and choirs of our time. A protege of Reverend Charles H. Nix Jr., a true pioneer of gospel music, he has been an integral part of the Detroit gospel music scene, serving as a musician, songwriter, and producer for some of the best loved music from Detroit. He performed on the Showtime special with the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin. In 1987, the group that Bishop Woods organized, Chosen, was honored by the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C. for their contribution to the history of gospel music as an art form. One of Bishop Woods' compositions, I Feel Like Going On, can be heard in the beloved movie, The Five Heartbeats. Bishop Woods is the organizer of the Interdenominational Assembly of Churches and past chapter representative of the Detroit chapter of the Gospel Music Workshop of America. So let's take this time to welcome all of tonight's distinguished panelists. We want to thank our viewers for joining this important conversation live by participating in our online watch party on YouTube and Facebook. So feel free to type in your comments and your questions for our panelists in the chat. We are monitoring the chat, so we will see your questions and we will try to get them on air. Also, we want you to like and share this broadcast to your pages and platforms so that your friends and family can be a part of this conversation too. So go ahead and click the like and the share button, and you will be an active part of this broadcast. So let's kick off the broadcast right now with a segment and a video featuring Dr. Deborah Smith Pollard as she shares some highlights of Detroit's history and significance in gospel music.
It reflects the message that the church is about, which is God loves us, Jesus Christ died for us, salvation is for all of us, and His mercy and grace is what gets us through even when we've not been so good, okay, and even when we're facing tough times. Now, the other part of it is that the music reflects the creativity of our community.
Lord, I thank you. I thank you for this. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for that. Right about down, 2 o'clock.
Chicago is, of course, called the birthplace of it because that's where Thomas Dorsey, Mahalia Jackson, and so many others came together or were situated there.
Falling and rising all these years, but you know my soul.
But when the convention, the National Convention of Gospel Choirs and Choruses, started in the 1930s, the third year after they were formed, they were here in Detroit, and Detroit embraced it. It goes back to even as early as the 1800s, the 19th century, is where we had basically a split in the black church. To this day, there are churches that are like, whoa, okay, this is kind of a lot. We can have the softer kind, the more you know, the quieter kind, but not that kind where people are clapping and playing tambourines and moving a lot. They don't want that kind. So, you know, this idea that every church does, every black church does everything the same way, no, that's not true.
Oh, a happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus wore.
When Edwin Hawkins brought in Oh Happy Day, oh my goodness, oh my goodness. He had an interview in a book with Dr. Bobby Jones, and he talks about how people came from the church and said, people are dancing at, you know, to your song in clubs. How dare you? Just you, that's not sacred. And of course, again, today it seems to be quite traditional. So then we move on to Kirk Franklin. And trust me, in a minute, there's going to be somebody else, you know, because we have trap, gospel. Oh no, they can't go together. Well, because the music comes from the community. Okay, it's not born in church. Let's just even say, when we think about Twinkie Clark and You Brought the Sunshine, she wasn't supposed to be listening to secular music, but she loved Stevie Wonder. She heard reggae, she included reggae with that one, and that song just to this day is one of the most beloved songs we have. So it reflects the gospel. She says, you know, it is a, won't he open doors for you? I'm talking about Jesus. I mean, that part of the lyrics in there still reflects the message, but the sound, the instrumentation changes over time.
La, la, la,
la, la, la,
let's party.
Some people are like, we want to sing quietly, we want to sound, let's just say, more European. And then there are others that we want to be ourselves. And so there was that split. So there is, I want to say, yeah, there continues to be that kind of dichotomy. Mm-hmm. And then even layers within the dichotomy. Just because some people think that a choir sound is what we should reflect to show that we have, what to them, evolved. Okay, and to other people, it's like, we want to sing the way that it reflects who we are. And we have a range of sound. In my first book, When the Church Becomes Your Party, the last chapter is about Christian rap, you know? And so I talk about how in some ways, you know, if people could just step back before they say, oh, that's not what we are. Okay, so there was an article I wrote, which is like, the ladies have on all their clothes, because I asked these young people, what makes gospel rap different from rap? And they said, women have on all their clothes. Okay, which just made me fall out laughing. I said, okay, that's going to be part of a title. Okay, so besides that point, certainly, again, the message is in place, the message of Jesus Christ.
God is.
God is.
God is. He is.
Play whatever you need, sing whatever you need to sing, you know, as long as that message is getting out. It's still the gospel, and that's okay.
No.
All right, that's our Dr. Deb right there. In the Black church, we know that music has always been a significant part of our worship on Sunday mornings. Let's start the questioning with Bishop Woods. Bishop, from a pastor's standpoint, what part does gospel music play in the Detroit Black Church?
The Detroit Black Church, as any church, when it comes to gospel music, because it is the direct message of the saving grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and salvation, the whole plan of redemption, we use that music to not only inspire, but to also share the jubilation and the celebration around the death, burial, and resurrection of our Savior, because it is on him where our faith hangs. So we thank God for the hymns of the church and the gospel songs that are called traditional that speak to that issue or speak to that subject matter to inspire, to instruct. And then, of course, in our experience, we love some good hand clapping, tambourine beating, and foot stomping good gospel music. So it's very important.
Amen. Amen. Now, the next question, we're going to go to Alvin. We can probably all agree that you can go to five churches in Detroit on any given Sunday and not quite have the same musical experience. As a minister of music for several large congregations, how do you select the music for your congregations that you minister to?
I think the most important part of selecting music for any congregation is you have to select music that speaks to the people that you're ministering to. And you have to meet people where they are. It's one thing to try to introduce people to new ideas, new concepts, new forms of expression. But at the end of the day, if they can't feel it, they don't benefit from it. So for instance, right now, I serve the music ministries of both Hope United Methodist and Southfield, and don't let the Methodists fool you. because we do something where some people call it Bapticostal.
That's right.
Depending on which Sunday you get there. Whereas I also serve on the ministry of music at the historic Hartford Memorial Baptist Church, which because of the long tenure of our pastor emeritus, Dr. Charles Adams, we do an anthem every Sunday. Every Sunday. We do hymns every Sunday, which I love. I grew up with hymns, so they're an integral part of my idea of a church experience, where there are churches now that it's not a part of their experience. So again, it depends on where you find yourself on any given Sunday as to, and you have to let the Spirit move you and let the Spirit speak to you so you can, in turn, through your ministry, speak to the congregants. That's our job, to speak through the Holy Spirit, let the Holy Spirit speak through us so that we reach and move people. That is the function of music in the Black church.
Amen. Amen. And you do it quite well. Deborah, you said in the clip that we just saw, the music is from the community. It is not born in the church. Has this always been the case? And if so, please elaborate on that.
What I mean is we don't sleep in the church. We don't live in the church. We live in the community. So all of the different kinds of sounds, jazz, blues, whatever is out there, new or even not so new, are the things that we often hear, even if we are from denominations that tell us that thou shalt not listen to that. I mean, when you're going to school, you still may hear it, or when you're in school, you may hear it, or when you go to eat dinner or whatever. And that's what I mean by it. So yes, we have certain music that, of course, we can say is from the church, but church people are from the community. So this is how we can get those layers of sound. I can remember, I won't name the name of the artist, and all of a sudden, while they were in church, the band started playing this song. And I said, is that? And somebody said, yes, it is. Okay, I'm just saying, because we hear all of this. And if you play piano and you hear somebody playing the piano really well, that just may kind of creep into your playing when you're sitting at the organ and they're just taking the offering. I'm just saying. Okay.
Amen. Amen. And at this time, we want to make sure that we remind the audience that this is an interactive watch party, and you can put your questions in the chat. We are monitoring the chat, so feel free to put your questions for the panelists about the gospel music right here in Detroit in the chat, and we will field your questions. So now we're going to hear from Reverend Robert Smith, who is the pastor of the New Bethel Baptist Church, as he shares the history of New Bethel that includes Reverend C.O. Franklin and his daughter, the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin. He also brings forth the deeper meaning and significance of gospel music within the African American life. Let's watch that clip.
Pastor Robert Smith, welcome to American Black Journal.
God bless you. And I'm just real excited about being here with you. I think this is a very, very important part of media, educational, informative, and inspiring.
Yeah. So I really want to talk to you about the role that gospel music plays, A, in your church, which has this incredibly rich history because of Aretha Franklin being in the choir there as a child and of course growing up in that church. But I also just want to talk about it more broadly and the role that the music plays in our faith in Detroit and in the Black community?
Well, certainly, if you are a student of history, you know that the slaves only made it by singing. My grandmother taught me the same thing. She would give me a task. I would hate doing it. I would stand there crying, trying to get through. And she said, listen, get your song. If it's just in your heart, even if it doesn't come from your lips, sing that song and you'll be through before you know it. And singing is a great reliever. It helps us to escape the agony of life in many ways. But Roy Jones said the only difference in the gospel and the blues was that one you called on your baby, the other you called on God, but the hope was the same. You would find relief in doing so. And certainly Reverend Franklin and Ray Charles, I think, understood that better than anybody, that it was all about relief from the everyday agonies of life.
All right. And that was a wonderful clip from Reverend Dr. Smith. We want to give some shout outs right now to some of the viewers that are watching live from Detroit, Michigan, Viola Sims and Karen Winston, a lifelong Detroiter, and also from Chicago, Illinois, M.K. Clark from Belleville, Michigan, Marion Rogers and Teresa Acton, all the way from Lexington, Kentucky, and Brenda Rubin from San Francisco Bay Area. And we want to make sure that you put your questions in the WVTC radio chat and whichever chat that you are on. We have one question before we get back into our next segment, and this is for Bishop Woods. Bishop, did you ever have a song that might have seemed out of pocket?
I got a book of those. Yes. Yes. Yes.
All right. All right. All right. And we're going to move forward. Thank you for that question, viewer. We're going to move forward to Lisa. Lisa, you've been a gospel soloist for many years. And Reverend Dr. Smith talked about the emotional connection and the deeper meaning in gospel music. How would you explain the role that gospel music plays in the continuity and health of the African-American community?
Great question. It is, as he said, it's a release, it's a relief. When you're singing, you are able to transcend how you may feel personally or mentally and think about the words of the music or the melody. They have a comforting way to comfort you, but also too, it allows those who are of the belief of the Holy Spirit for it to come and to, because the Holy Spirit is that comforter. And I believe that's how the Holy Spirit can speak to us and comfort us, is through the beauty of music, either instrumentally and again, the joy and the release that you have of singing. Sometimes we sing quietly, other times we let loose, you know, but it's an opportunity for you to share those emotions and connect with the Father through that beauty of music.
Amen, amen. And that is so true. Alvin, you were minister of music of New Bethel, and Reverend Smith just talked about the church, and that was a tall order. Now, what part did the musical tradition of that church play in your determining what you were going to do musically to serve that congregation?
Well, that was an interesting experience. My home church was St. Stephen AME. So I grew up AME, and if it wasn't in a hymnal, or an anthem, we probably didn't sing it for most of my upbringing. Even though I actually grew up down the street from New Bethel, I had never been there. And the minister of music at the time, a fellow, Reverend Chris Hale, invited me. He heard me playing over at Carter Metropolitan CME. And he said, you need to come over to New Bethel. I said, you've got to be kidding. And I came while the great Dr. Thomas H. Shelby was still the minister of music there.
Amen.
And they had such a tremendous rich history. This is a church that still had a live broadcast every Sunday at 9 p.m. And it was packed at 9 p.m. On what was it, WGPR, I believe. on the radio, and there was just this whole history of classic gospel music that they were doing there that I had never heard before, but that's again that's what spoke to them. So even though that was entirely outside of my history. And that's one thing that as gospel musicians, we have to adapt to. It may not be a part of our experience, but we have to make it a part of our program because we have to serve the congregations where the Lord places us. So I was introduced to this wonderful genre of music, this traditional gospel music, which still today resonates so incredibly. And I take that with me everywhere I go to try to teach the current generation. I said, you need to know this music because even the people that we idolize as contemporary, like Thomas Whitfield, they were steeped in that tradition.
That's right.
You know, and it speaks to even their music, because it's got staying power. You know, as I believe it was Vicky Winans once said, you know, some of the stuff that they're singing now is not just contemporary; it's just temporary.
It's temporary.
it's nice, but it doesn't stick. So you know, sometimes you've got to reach back for something that has permanence. There's a reason that we're still singing Precious Lord. There's a reason that these things still resonate because they still have that power. They're authentic, which is not to dissuade from the current CCM or anything else. It's all good, honey. Whatever gets you through the day,
that's right,
is a gift from God. So whatever speaks to you in any given moment is blessed and holy and wonderful. Again, tradition. So I think that most important thing that I garnered from my time at New Bethel was that sense of the value of traditional gospel and historical perspective.
Amen. Amen. And that's good. That's good. Bishop Woods, we're going to stay right there in the New Bethel frame. And yeah. We know that you shared the stage with Miss Franklin. Aretha, yeah. How did your style of playing change when you accompanied her, and how did that experience add depth to your musical approach?
Well, I knew her musician, Nikki, at the time, would come to Detroit all the time, and Miss Franklin didn't want us to change anything. She wanted Reverend Nix and J.D. and the St. James Adult Choir sound behind her. So I felt very comfortable. I said, I wiped the sweat from my brow because we rehearsed the songs. And she said, I want you to play everything you know on the organ. So what I did was just do what I do naturally. And she was pleased. So that was a relief because we were singing songs that we had adapted in our music repertoire that she had recorded, you know, from the Amazing Grace album anyway. So that was very easy. Thank God for that experience.
Yeah, and so now did that add anything to your musical style? Or we know that you were just, you know, you were playing what you knew, but just the fact that you were playing for Aretha.
Well, I was conscious of the fact, like I was taught by my mentors to, be an accompanist. That helped polish me the more to play for someone who I knew I had to follow, because her being a musician herself and an accomplished singer, there was no way I could skip any beats or miss any chords or any notes. So it really taught me to be more conscious of the moment musically. At the same time, she has still allowed us a window of improvisation and creativity, but stick with the song, because I'm the singer, not I'm the star on this stage, not you on that organ or that piano. So that was a very humbling and learning experience during that whole time.
Amen. Amen. And that's something that I'm sure that will live with you forever.
Forever.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
So right now, let's talk about the Gospel Music Workshop of America that was organized right here in Detroit in 1968 by the King of Gospel, Reverend James Cleveland. We know that the purpose was to be a training ground for singers and musicians to display their talent, learn a new style of gospel music, and to be able to execute it correctly with confidence and competence. I'm going to call some names, and I want to give you an opportunity to briefly tell me what they meant to you and the formation of the Detroit sound. Now, we'll start with you, Bishop Woods. Elma Lois Hendricks Parham.
Elma Lois Hendricks was not only just a musician, but a businesswoman, a songwriter, a publisher, and she led one of the largest women courses in the country at Greater New Mount Moriah, where my brother and I, Gregory Troy, and I had a chance to accompany them, and we would go on their road trips with her as her musicians. And of course, she was also a music teacher for me and many others right there at Elma Hendricks, the House of Music, right there on Orange Street. So that was a blessing.
Amen. What about Reverend Charles Ashley Craig II?
Oh, Charles Ashley Craig II was a musical genius. I had never seen anybody direct the way he did, play the way he did. He could set up a song. I think that's where Reverend Cleveland got it from. We called him affectionately CA.
Yeah.
He could get up and narrate and walk through a song. I'll never forget that one song in the arrangement of Beautiful Dreamer.
Blessed Assurance.
Blessed Assurance. I had never heard nothing like that in my life. And I just left there mesmerized because of his musical genius. All of the instruments are going at the same time. You know, they had that organ up there.
Yes.
On the high organ. And that's the right. Organ on the floor and the pianos. I was like, where am I? You know, I'd never seen church in that fashion. So he was not only a people magnet, a composer, a director, and a musician extraordinaire.
All right, let's keep this going with you, Bishop. Reverend Charles H. Nix Jr., your mentor.
Oh, my God. That was my hands-on mentor from about 10 years old. My brother and I were taking music lessons from him down at Worcester. And my mother allowed me to go to the church. The rest is history there. To make a long story short, when he asked me to travel with him, I started traveling with Pastor Nix because of the Gospel Music Workshop of America. He was over the chapter reps, and he needed a musician to go with him to visit all of the chapters. And sometime he would send me ahead to prep the choir, then he would come. And eventually I became church organist at St. James Baptist Church, and then got a chance to record, and he allowed me a chance to produce and to write songs. So that was an awesome, life-changing experience for me. I can never forget it.
Amen. Beverly Glenn.
Beverly Glenn was a writer before her time, in my estimation, because she pulled such gifted, talented musicians together, such as Thomas Whitfield. I met Tommy back then when he was playing for Beverly Glenn. Some of the songs that she penned, if people heard them, you would swear she wrote them yesterday because of their relevance. And my friend Alvin Waddles was saying, songs like she wrote got what I call gospel music longevity.
Yes.
In other words, the gospel, the preached word don't expire. Neither does good gospel music. It lives because it's the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. So she was an amazing teacher, songwriter, and of course, she was one of the ones that Alma Hendricks had published. And if people go back and look at her history, you will find the recordings of Beverly Glenn. Everything she wrote, in my estimation, you could sing on Sunday morning.
That's right. That's everything. Right. That's right. One last one for you, Bishop. John Everhart.
John Everhart was a people magnet. He was what I call a good country gospel musician, that foot stomping pianist that could lock in a time. And he orchestrated a choir with such unique vocal abilities. I don't know where he got these people from, but that's a choir where everybody just passed the mic. Everybody could lead. You know, if a leader was missing, they had backup. And they, matter of fact, I think they got the honors of the oldest, longest living community choirs in the city of Detroit. And I had a chance to meet him. And of course, you know, he was one of the chapter reps in the early days of the Gospel Music Workshop of America. So he was a great guy to sit at his feet and to glean. And he was one of the guys that let us come to their rehearsals to learn how to teach 4-part, 6-part harmonies. They were singing back then, you know, they talk about 3-part harmony, but they were doing 4, 5, 6, splitting everybody. Mm-hmm. And he was just a genius at what he did. I appreciate the opportunity to share with him.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Bishop. I'm going to move over to Alvin. Alvin, tell us about Frank White.
About the professor, Frank White.
Professor Frank White.
Professor, yes. I grew up, again, as I mentioned earlier, I grew up in St. Stephen African-American Episcopal Church, and Frank White was on and off the minister of music there. So I grew up listening to Frank every Sunday. And we actually studied with the same piano teacher when he was younger. He studied with a woman named Gussie Dickey, who was my first piano teacher. So we had a connection, and he took me under his wing. He taught me a great deal because he appreciated and excelled at all types of music. He could play classical. He did the Messiah. He did gospel. He brought a level of gospel music that St. Stephen had never heard. He brought singers from all over the city because he played all over the city. One of the most impressive things about Frank White was his ability to sit down to any instrument. I mean, if it was a Wurlitzer, if it was a Casio, he could find sounds and registrations and make it sound just amazing. I mean, he just had a gift for doing that, whether it was a big pipe organ or anything. He really was a genius. Left us far too soon, but he had an amazing contribution to the Detroit music scene and an amazing impact on my life.
Amen. And I might add, he was the first person that I had ever heard on a pipe organ play praise music. I didn't know you could do that.
Absolutely.
But he whipped it right up. Let's go with another one. Herbert Picard.
Herbert Picard was, in many ways, an architect in terms of the Detroit gospel sound, particularly at the Hammond organ. I remember one time I was at a large funeral. I was at New Bethel, as a matter of fact. And a lot of times that's the only time that all of us musicians would see each other, was at large things like that, musicals. And we were all standing outside because, of course, we weren't paying attention to what was going on in service because we hadn't seen each other. And we were just talking and had one of Tommy, Gregory Choi, a bunch of us standing outside the door, and we weren't paying attention to anything. But when Herbert Picard got on the organ and started to play, everyone fell silent. And it was the economy of what he did. There was never anything extra, never anything extraneous. Everything was musically sound and relevant. His registrations were just, they were so intuitive. And he was a tremendous choir director. He had the Mighty Voices of Thunder, you can hear on the old recordings, you know, everything he did was in the service of the music. It was never showy, even though it was fascinating to listen to, but it was all in service. He was just the nicest person, you know, just the most humble soul. But, you know, just an amazingly talented musician. He was Thomas Whitfield's greatest. Tommy always said that was his biggest inspiration. He got, you know, was Herbert Picard, Pee-wee, right, as we called him.
Yeah, Pee-wee. Let's go to Thomas Whitfield then, the maestro.
Thomas Whitfield, the maestro, the maestro. Again, I put him in the category with so many other great musicians, not just gospel musicians, but just musicians who were so far ahead of their time that we're still trying to keep up and figure out what he was doing and hear it the way he heard it. I can't imagine what he would be doing now, but I know he would still be at the forefront of gospel music if he was still with us. Much like Beverly Glenn, as Bishop said, you can listen to anything Tommy wrote and you can sing it today and it would still be contemporary and groundbreaking and revelatory. He was such an amazing pianist, and you can hear the influences. He used to listen to Oscar Peterson, a lot of jazz, a lot of R&B, but he had a way of incorporating all of these genres in his music and but it was still always holy. It was always holy and sanctified. And he just had a gift at that because he was a very pure heart. And I just remember I was a relatively young and new to the scene when I first met him, but he was always like Donald Vales, like Reverend Nix. They were always so encouraging to young people. You know, they would take you and they would allow you to sit in on the rehearsals and they just respected you and encouraged you to be all that you could be. And I never forget that. He was always very kind to me and gave me opportunities that helped shape what I hope to become one day, God willing.
Yeah. Amen. Let's give one more for you. I'm gonna reach back and get this one. Alfred Bowden
was known as the world's greatest organist, and for good reason. Pee-wee used to talk about Alfred Bowden and things he learned. And again, it was that one thing that separated them was their knowledge of the registration. Pulling in the right stops out, getting the right sound from the organ for the right occasion. He was one of the earliest to really make recordings of just solo organ playing. Which dates back all the way to, you know, you didn't hear playing like that since the early 20s, 30s, when Fats Waller was making. Yeah, I know that we're going off topic here, but it all connects. Fats Waller used to had recordings of him playing the organ, popular tunes, and you know, he took that kind of tradition and applied it to gospel music and made it saleable and revelatory and moving, because he was just a genius at his craft. He was also a great choir director, and a great teacher. So he really was the architect of, you know, musicians who followed Pee Wee and Reverend Nix and of course Bishop Woods, you know, all of whom carried that weight and that expertise to what they do. So we are indebted to him for his contributions to this genre.
Amen. And a lot of people don't know that the organ was a fairly new instrument when Alfred Bowden was playing it, and he mastered it.
Yes, it was new then, even though probably some of the organs he beat into submission are still floating around at these churches. because some of these organs at these churches are from the 50s and 60s. They were fresh when he was on them. So imagine that.
Amen. Dr. Deb, I'm going to come to you now. Dr. Maddie Moss Clark.
Listen, to see a woman who was such a powerhouse was so inspirational to me as a singer, a songwriter, a choir director, a musician. For someone who was over the music department for the Church of God in Christ, but who always was reaching out to young people. I remember the first time we interviewed Vanessa Bell Armstrong and asked her about Maddie Moss Clark, and she just grabbed her heart. you know, she just couldn't even talk for like 30 seconds. She just said, I can't even express how much she meant to me. And certainly we know what she did to help shape the Clark sisters, but just so many other young people who came through the UNAC and other parts of the Church of God Convention, but just in the community. If I can just say this right quick, she had me come and MC some programs, and you know, the artists would come in and then they'd be gone, and I'd be there for like 3 or 4 hours MCing. But she taught me a lot, which is, you know, just try to read the room, right? And don't make it all about you. Make it about these artists and about God's grace in this great music. So she was wonderful to me. Yeah, that's what I have to say about her.
All right, let's go to the next one. Mm-hmm. Harold Smith.
Watching his hands direct a choir just amazed me. It just amazed me. Going to, let me take a deep breath and say it, Ford Auditorium. Okay. And watching them, you know. And I remember running into one of his lead singers on the street. You would have thought I'd run into somebody from Motown or something. I could hardly breathe, you know. And I said, oh my goodness, I saw you last night. And I just want to say how much I enjoyed it. He said, thank you, young lady. I really appreciate that. But just, you know, yes, we appreciate that we have many artists from our city who've made, you know, gotten Grammys and, you know, all kinds of big kinds of awards. But just being able to interact with individuals who impacted this city was incredible. And watching his hands was just incredible.
Amen. Speaking of hands, we're going to go with one of my mentors, Jimmy J.D. Dow.
I know we shouldn't use the word favorite, but he just truly was one of my favorites. His personality, the way he directed. I have a friend who looks like us, but is Jewish. And she just said, I don't care what I pay for a ticket to come to a gospel concert. Seeing him makes it worth it. Okay. All just seeing him by himself is worth it. And I think about from the Remembering Detroit concert.
Yes.
And Detroit. And just one of those songs that he directed, I think it's got close to 7 million views.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I could watch it close to a million times myself, because every time it just makes me smile. It makes me feel good. But that's what he did all the time, just with his personality. And of course, his songwriting. Let's not forget, I Really Love the Lord, which is in a bunch of hymn books as well. I think people forget he could also do that, as well as really direct a choir wonderfully.
All right. All right. Let's go with Lucille Lemon, Dr. Lucille Lemon.
So my father was the pastor of the Eagleton Baptist Church, a little church on the east side of Detroit. And every year he would have the Lemon Gospel Singers come. So I'm a kid and I'm hearing that they've got, let me see, the Lemonaires, the Lemonettes. And I think there was the Lemon Specials. And I think my dad made up one like the Lemon Squeezers or something. It would just crack me up. But I loved it because, again, seeing a woman who had charge was empowering to me. And even when she had to start directing from a wheelchair,
yeah,
still was in power. So what can I tell you? She was wonderful. Enjoyed the music and I loved all those names.
Amen.
Oh, by the way, that's where Pop Winans and Mom Winans met each other. And
that's right.
Yeah. So amen to her for that too.
Amen. Amen. You can find love in the choir.
Yeah, you can.
Okay. And now let's go with one of your people that's near to your heart, Donald Bales.
Well, the first time I heard his voice, he was with Elma Lois Hendricks Parham in the community choir and a community youth dance. And I was saying to somebody, oh my gosh, I really like that voice. And somebody said, you know, you could join that choir. I could join the choir with somebody who sings like that. Yes, you can. So I was in there as a teenager and my sister and I joined in there. And then later on, when he started the Donald Bales Choraliers, let me make it clear, I was one of the two young ones in there. But anyway, I was one of the first to join in the original Donald Bales Choraliers. And he made a big difference in my life. At one point when I was an undergrad, I had the choir come up to Michigan State and sing. And it was just great to be able to not only be in a choir that sang that beautifully, but to be able to share it. You know, on a campus where this is not a Christian campus, you know, people doing what they do on campuses. But I wanted to share the gospel music. And so made a big difference. And are you talking about somebody who could arrange a song?
Yeah.
Even as the stage is rising at Ford Auditorium, he's giving us new parts. You're going like, what? Okay, but that's just what Donald did. You know, stuff would come to him in the moment. And we learned to just be in the moment with him. You're going to be in the Donald Bills court. Be right there. And he allowed me to be an announcer. You know, I think what I tell everybody, half of Detroit can sing, the other half can really sing. I can sing okay, but I can talk pretty well. And he allowed me to start talking before I even got on the radio. So I always appreciated him for that too.
Amen. And we loved every minute of you guys learning those songs as the stage was going up. We were sitting there with on tiptoe anticipation.
The same way we were feeling, yes.
Yeah, we waited for it. But all of those people that we just named and we gave you a brief history about, all of those people they helped to form the Gospel Music Workshop of America right here in Detroit, Michigan. And that's something that we have that we will never forget. It was started right here in 1968. At King Solomon Baptist Church, right there in August of 1968. And it's been going. This is the 55th year for the convention, and it's still going. We're going to go right now. Let's go to a song by the Detroit chapter of the Gospel Music Workshop of America. We'll be right back after this. Remember, this is a watch party, and you can put your comments and your questions into the chat, and we will get to them. We'll be right back.
Oh,
Amen, amen, amen. Now, you had to have felt something there. You had to have felt something there. And we heard the first song, Lord Help Me to Hold Out, and that was a tribute to Harold Smith and Majestics. He recorded that with the King of Gospel, Reverend James Cleveland, and we saw none other than Bishop Woods. We saw none other than Bishop Woods on the Hammond organ. And on the next song, we saw him right there on the Hammond organ. And we saw none other than Detroit's own Brother Michael Fletcher, Dr. Michael Fletcher. And he was directing the choir. And that's some of Detroit's finest. And that's just what we do with gospel music right here in the D. We have a couple viewer comments, and thank you guys for commenting. We've got one from Roosevelt Hamilton, who's watching on the GMWA Facebook page. Dr. Woods, do you ever think that we can hear hymns and anthems in these New Year's?
Yes, I really believe that they're coming back as the choir comes back. I've also challenged myself and some of my colleagues to write new hymns, to write something that can be of today or be accepted by those of us that are here. And again, those hymns are not dated. They don't have expiration dates. So I really do believe if the younger generation, the more they're exposed to them, I believe that they will lock in and see what we've been talking about. They'll experience those hymns for themselves.
Amen, amen. And we've got another viewer, Teresa is saying that an hour is just not gonna be long enough for this. All right, and I agree. We've got a viewer comment from MK Clark, who is watching on Facebook. Lisa's musical ministry has soothed, comforted, and uplifted so many people over the years. Amen, amen. That was a beautiful comment, amen. And thank you, we're still taking comments in the chat. So this is a watch party, so go ahead and put your comments in the chat and we will get to them. Amen. So moving on to our next segment, I've had the pleasure of working with each of you. This question is to anyone, and I'm going to ask probably Lisa to start this off. How does gospel music bring us together as a community of musicians and singers?
Oh, great question. First, I just have to say, I'm just humbled to be on this panel with these dynamic musicians and experts around music. As a novice, you know, I just sing. I think music, gospel music, allows the person like me who just loves to sing and they can be a part. They don't have to be the lead. They don't have to be an expert. They don't have to be trained, but have a heart to want to sing God's music and to listen and follow great leaders like Mr. Waddles or Bishop, to follow that direction and to learn and have an open spirit to want to learn the music. I've been blessed to, like I shared and you shared in the opening comments, the first choir I've ever belonged to is the one at Greater Christ. And I joined it 10, 11 years ago when I first came to the church under the dynamic Marcus Holmes, who is our music minister there at Greater Christ. And that he was able to work with somebody like me who I just love God's music and want to be able to use the gift that I feel that he's given me and to guide us. You know, organized singing in the choir, it gives discipline. It gives opportunity also from an aging perspective. As an aging professional, learning music helps you with brain health. Some people who have dementia or brain memory loss can remember music, or when they hear music, it awakens their spirit or it awakens them. So I think gospel music not only has those kind of scientific sides, but also on the spiritual and the common man side, how it allows everybody can participate in the composition and the singing of the music.
Amen. And now, Alvin, you talked earlier about standing outside of the church, and you were with Tommy and others. This same question to you. How does gospel music bring us together as a community of musicians and singers?
I think that much of gospel music, particularly when you're talking about choirs and that sort of presentation, it's a collaborative effort. And it brings us together because we have a commonality of purpose in, we're all striving to create the same thing for the same result, to reach people. And you have to work together to do that. So you kind of have to lose yourself and diminish yourself as the greater goal. The purpose of ministry has to be foremost in what we're doing. And there's something about being, you know, making less of yourself so God can make more of all of you that just draws you together as a people, as a community. You know, so often we have to focus so much on individual achievement, but coming together for a common purpose, it can't help but give a positive result. Because, you know, as we pray often, Lord, you know, diminish me that you might increase, you know, yes. That ideal, I think, flows through gospel music at its best.
Amen. Now, Bishop, we know that drummers know drummers and guitar players know guitar players. How does this gospel music bring us together as a community of musicians?
Well, because of the music itself, the opportunities that it presents to all of us to collaborate, to fellowship. One thing I love about the Detroit climate, and I'm just, you know, kind of, you know, to Detroit because I'm a Detroiter. I don't know what they do around the country, but it's such a blessing that my career includes being able to share my gift with other community choirs, other churches. We always invite each other to be guest musicians. You know, if we needed a musician, we'll invite somebody. You know, that's how I got my start, being invited out to pray for the Voices of Tabernacle, to play for St. James, to play for John Everhart, all these choirs. And when Alma Hendricks knew I could play, she hurried up and snatched me out the choir and started putting me on the piano. And then, of course, my career, I would say 65% of my musical career is owed to the Gospel Music Workshop of America, because it was through them that I became a workshop facilitator. When Donald couldn't go, he called me, or called Jeffrey LaValle. When Reverend couldn't go, or Charles Fole. They were the main three. Of course, Ed Smith had a lot to do with it, but they were the main ones that will throw a workshop my way and say, listen, I can't go to Chicago. I need you to go. I can't go to Indiana. I need you to go. I happily packed my bag and went, and they had that experience. And from there, at every convention, I did not leave a GMWA convention without the next year being booked because of that opportunity. And so it brought us together, and we look forward to going to the workshop. Because we would stay up, you know, Sandy, we stay up to 3-4 o'clock in the morning after the musicals in the ballrooms, around the organ, around the piano, just exchanging, just sharing the new music seminars. I mean, and we did that here in Detroit with Tommy, with JD, and JD would cook some pork chops and grab us all. We'd all go over and we go to Reverend's house, and we just had our time. We meet up at all the restaurants, know all of us today. We could own somebody, especially Big Boys and Boneyard and a whole lot of, I don't get into that.
Ooh, and Howard Johnson's.
But that's what we did. We love commuting together and traveling together and getting together to just have fellowship. That's what it was all about.
Amen. And we are not going to leave you out, Dr. Deb. Tell us about how gospel music can brings us together as a community of musicians and singers.
I'm thinking about Gospel Fest and Praise Fest. We're outside for 22 straight years. And when I run into younger people and they say, oh my God, my family used to come all the time. It was, you know, one of our scheduled, you know, calendar events that we'd come to. It makes me just feel wonderful because it was a time. I would see musicians all clumped together sometimes, like you say, you know, and then singers who were talking to each other. And somebody reminded me of the day that there were musicians who would bring a guitar from home, even though they weren't playing, so they could come backstage so they could get with the rest of them. But it was a time to do that. And of course, the folks who were just out there in the audience were just apparently having a good time. And so it was just a great experience to be there. When people say, can you do it again? I'm like, sure, if you got 125 grand, let me know. We can do it. Because we had some really big sponsors for a long time. Farmer Jack, which no longer exists. Ford, which at one time, I mean, right now they're back, but after a long period, they sort of were like on the edge of bankruptcy. But for a long time, we had wonderful sponsors, and it really made it great to be able to bring everybody together. Local artists, regional artists, and national artists were there together, and that was a wonderful time.
Amen. Amen. And we have a comment from Kimberly Price McDade, who is watching live on Facebook, and she saw the late, great Daryl Houston on that video. Oh, man. That, you know, we have to have part two and part three and part four of this, because there are just so many people that we could not name today that made significant contributions to the Detroit sound. And so we want to make sure that we get that in. We have another question from the audience, and this is from Donald Weber, who's watching on Facebook. He asked, Bishop Woods, the way you play is such an awesome style, but it's fading away. Are you teaching it to any of the millennial generation?
Well, I'm making the effort to do so if they want it. You know, like my grandfather said, you can take a horse to the water, but you can't make them drink. All I can do is avail myself, and we definitely want to do that. And we're going to be sponsoring online and some in-person workshops. I'm going to gather the crew and Alvin, get ready, and some of these other seasoned musicians. You know, they call us old school, but I tell them, you need all of that school. It's just school. Take the whole off, because y'all going to keep having birthdays too. You know, I want to be able to share this, and so many others have the same sentiment that they want to share what they know and pass it on to the next generation. We want to keep this music alive.
Amen. And we all know that a steak is good, but it's better with seasoning. Amen. Amen. Now, I'm going to ask each of you this again. This is the same question. And I want you to describe the impact that gospel music has had on your life. And we'll start with Dr. Deb.
Well, because I had parents who were so involved in music of all kinds. It was, people always ask, well, why gospel? Why did you end up studying it, etc.? Because it just meant so much to me, because I love the Lord, because I love the range of sounds in gospel music. So it's had an impact on my academic career. It's had an impact on me being able to be in radio for all these decades. And it has an impact on my personal life, because just, you know, whether it's a great day or a mediocre day or a not wonderful time, there are such great gospel music songs that I can put on that can take me through those moments. And so is that quite an impact on him. The last thing I'll say is I met my husband on a blind date. And because we both knew about Frank White, I was like, oh, okay.
It'll work.
This will work.
Amen. Amen. Alvin, same question. What, describe the impact that gospel music has had on your life.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, I've been in church all of my life, but I grew up in a relatively conservative church environment. We sang a lot of hymns and a lot of anthems and not so much gospel as we understand it today. So when I was exposed to it, I found it fascinating. I mean, I was a classical musician, and that's the music that spoke to my heart on so many levels. But I was amazed by the impact, the immediacy of gospel music. It just resonates so quickly and so intensely with the spirit, and the way it could change and shift a service, and its flow, its ability to flow with the spirit. It seemed like such a genuine expression. And I believe that even today, I'm a great believer that, you know, though music doesn't necessarily save, there's nothing that the Bible tells us that music will save you. It's the word of God that will save you. But what music is, has the ability to do, as Reverend Smith alluded to, is it's relief. So it's like the process of plowing a field, and tilling the soil so that a seed can be planted. If you can't get a seed through hard ground, you have to till the soil and make it receptive. And that's what music has the ability to do. It has the ability to break through barriers so that people can receive God and hear him more clearly, because it gets rid of so much anxiety and angst. It is a soothing, it is a balm. What is said, there is yet a balm in Gilead. And that's what music has the ability to do. So that's how it has impacted my life. I turn to, there are times that, you know, you don't have another recourse, but I can listen to some gospel music. I can say, fortunately, the Lord bless me, if I can't find what I want, I can sit down to the piano and play it myself. And because what Don Lawrence said, sometimes you've got to encourage yourself. Mm-hmm. And so that's what it is. It has that ability to soothe and relieve. And that's why it is an irreplaceable part of my life, because it is something that I can always turn to in moments of need. As well as in moments of celebration, on both sides of the spectrum, it fits.
All right. Lisa.
Well, I grew up in church all of my life, and I was a reluctant singer before I grew up in Wolverine State Convention, and my uncle, the late Avery Aldridge, I would sing a solo before he'd preach. And I remember being around gospel music in that aspect. Fast forward to adulthood and having, and you know, they say, you know how to go to church and know where God lives, but do you really know him? And through my musical journey of just my own self-discovery and learning how I enjoy singing now as an adult, not a reluctant singer, but now, whereas Mr. Waddles just said, encouraging myself in the Lord through the music. Joy is my portion, and my singing, when I'm singing, it's a way that joy can come out through the music, but also hopefully inspiring others to feel joy, but also to share comfort. I sang all the music for my father's funeral and his homegoing. And I loved him, but he loved to hear me sing. I sang when he was living, but I also wanted to, as my last act of service and singing him through and getting him, and technically singing him all the way out of the church as his casket left out. But it was not from a place of sadness. It was from a place of joy and how the Lord comforted me and held me up while I was singing and ministering in that way. And I thank God for the gift of music and the gift that gospel music has been in my church, in my life, and also in the life of the church and the life of his kingdom. And I'm just humbled because I admire all of the folks on this panel today, and hope that someone who's thinking about, well, you know, I can't sing that good, join the choir. Think about it. Join a choir or sing along with the choir when you're in church, either virtually, it's even safer virtually now, or singing when you go to in-person services, because God wants to hear your voice. He wants to hear you.
Amen. Yeah. All right, Bishop. Bishop.
Well, I'm like my counterparts here. Listen, I've been in church all my life. That's all I know. And since gospel music has been my life, ministry with music, all of my life, and I'm blessed and got the testimony that the Lord has allowed me to make a modest, good income and living just from being full-time in ministry, and music was such a great part of that. And I didn't know what residual income was and multiple streams was until, you know, I was taught by some of the best, you know, Reverend Nixon, then Tommy, you know, when I started writing and putting out songs, and they taught me how to get covered. And the rest is history, you know. It's almost that time now to go to what we call the mailbox blessing. I've been getting it for 20 to 30, 40 years.
God is good.
And here is the thing, while gospel music was a blessing to me, I got to travel around the world. I mean, Japan, Sweden, London, England. I mean, all of these places, all over Canada and all over the United States, you know, expenses paid, you know, and they paid me for coming. But when I started out, my grandfather said, now I paid for your music lesson. I paid for all of your books and everything. Now you're going to play for the church and you're going to pay tithes. We're not going to pay you to play and practice on us. It wasn't until I kind of moved on that I knew that people got paid. I said, wait a minute, y'all get paid for playing? You know, and that's how I got started. So music has played a definite wonderful part of my life when it comes to the income, the learning experience, and the friends that I've met, the relationships that I've garnered. I mean, I couldn't ask for more than what I've experienced working with Reverend James Cleveland. I mean, some of the best. I met Lawrence Roberts. I met Walter Hawkins, Edwin Hawkins, Tommy Whitfield, Beverly Glenn, Maddie Clark. I mean, I can just call the roll. I was there as a child to sit at their feet, Herbert Picard, Donald Vales. And so that's why music and gospel music is so important to me, because I feel like I have whatever influence I have now that they're gone. I was a student then, so now I become one of the fathers.
That's right.
So now I got to help train this next generation, help them to understand the importance of keeping the legacy alive.
Amen. Amen. And those were wonderful answers, responses to that question from each of you. We have one last viewer question from Marcus Holmes. You're a minister of music there. And he says, such an august panel of gospel music excellence and history. Any plans to curate some online curriculums that could be accessed on demand, like masterclass opportunities?
Well, yes, there's something in the works that's coming soon. It's called Coming Soon. It's a coming attraction that we just don't want to put the cart before the horse. But yeah, we've talked about it with many people, and we're putting the nuts and bolts in so that we can present something that I think gonna be worldwide.
Amen. Amen. Well, we want to thank you all and thank the audience for what they've done. We've got a video right now, and we'll be right back after this video.
On the next American Black Journal, our Black Church in Detroit series continues with the examination of the history of gospel music and its connection to other genres. I'll talk with a minister who's also a blues musician, plus a look back at some gospel performances here on the show. That's Tuesday at 7:30 p.m. and again on Sunday at 9:30 a.m.
Gospel music, Black gospel music, is an offset of the Negro spiritual. One of the main differences between the two is that we are not exactly aware of the composers of Wade in the Water, or Joshua Fit, the Battle of Jericho, or Did My Lord Deliver Daniel. However, there are known composers of famous gospel songs like Oh Happy Day, Edwin Hawkins, or Total Praise, Richard Smallwood. And so while there are certainly similarities between the two, there are certainly differences between. But both are certainly influential to the culture and the fabric of American music and America in general.
All right, and you know that we are a community, and that was all of our nephew, Brandon, Dr. Brandon, all of our nephew, except for Alvin. We'll talk about that just one minute. Our next episode of the Black Church in Detroit on American Black Journal will air on Detroit Public Television tomorrow night, June 28th at 7:30 p.m. This new episode is also focused on gospel music and has all new content centered on the gospel music of Detroit and the influence on other, its influence on other genres, and includes an interview with tonight's panelist, Alvin Waddles' son, Dr. Brandon Waddles, and you saw a bit of that. So, Alvin, the very last question is going to go to you. As you are, your son Brandon is really making his mark on Detroit and in the world as far as music. What do you think the legacy will be that your family will be leaving in the Detroit gospel music?
Well, particularly with my son, Dr. Waddles, besides the, just the legacy of headgear in the church, which is substantial in his case, he has done great work. He actually did his dissertation on the maestro, Thomas Whitfield, and he has been instrumental in getting much of Minister Whitfield's music written down. And it is circulating all across the country. Colleges and choirs are doing it all across the nation who were not familiar with his work or were only familiar with it through recordings, but did not have the ability to pick things up simply by listening to it. So now all sorts of churches and denominations of various colors and hues. So, you know, he has been instrumental in furthering the scope and the reach of that the maestro throughout the country, and again, that is the maestro Thomas Whitfield is a Detroit legacy. He's part of our history. He's part of our sound. Much of and because Brandon travels all over the country, doing workshops and things, and people hear him playing. He also plays now for Lettucey. And that's what we find. The Detroit sound is a very singular and unique sound. And the reason that it is, you hear it everywhere, is because Detroit musicians play for everyone. In all where you can find them in bands playing for, you know, R&B artists, hip hop artists, in churches all across the nation. They seek musicians out from Detroit because we are who we are. I mean, there's just such a tremendous pool of talent here, but we take our sound with us. So even, you know, if you're listening to other, you know, other church recordings or other recordings, you can hear it. You can hear it. And I think that is our, that is all of our legacy, that we contribute to gospel music across the country and across the world. It is that sound that is so unique to Detroit.
Okay, well, thank you so much. You guys have such a wonderful legacy there with the Waddles and each one of our panelists. You all are magnificent. Thank you so much, Dr. Deb, Lisa, Alvin, and Bishop Woods. We want to thank you all for joining us tonight. And we want to thank all of those who are watching tonight. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thank all of you who liked and shared this broadcast. It's not too late. You can still like and share it. You can hit that button right now and like and share. And we like to thank those who sent those great questions and comments in. So tell your friends about the Facebook group, The Black Church in Detroit, and invite them to join so that we can continue these great conversations there. We also invite church groups to continue these conversations within your congregation. The Black Church in Detroit initiative was made possible by support from WETA, which is the Washington Educational Television Association in Washington, D.C., and AAA. We also want to thank all the ongoing supporters of American Black Journal. Thanks to our producers of this watch party event. Thank you, Colleen O'Donnell, Tammy Wenzel, and our advisory panel liaison, Marty Fischoff, from the Detroit Public Television, and to all of our esteemed panelists, Deborah, Lisa, Alvin, and Bishop Woods. We want to thanks again to our great partners who helped us to make this evening possible, including the Charles H. Wright Museum of African American History and the Ecumenical Theological Seminary, and to all of our distinguished advisory panel. Watch for new episodes of The Black Church in Detroit on American Black Journal at the last Tuesday of every month at 7:30 p.m. with an encore broadcast on the following Sunday at 9:30 a.m. You can get more details about the Black Church in Detroit initiative at onedetroitpbs.org/abj-church. Thank you, everyone, for joining. I'll see you online. Night, night.